Grace and peace be with you, and welcome to this service of worship in which we are celebrating Reformation Day. That day of October 31st, 1517, it was the day when Martin Luther nailed the 95 Theses to the church door. He was sharing his opposition to various doctrines and practices of the Roman Catholic Church of his day. It was 500 years ago this year in 1521 that Luther was officially decreed a heretic and an outlaw. We continue to give God thanks for his courage and the courage of so many others as they continue to speak their convictions and their beliefs. We are grateful our Presbyterian Church is grounded in this Reformed tradition. So welcome to this Reformation worship. We have many ways that you can find out more about our life together as a PCUSA congregation, as Highland Presbyterian. We encourage you to visit our website, highlandpres.org. While you're there, you can find a bulletin to aid you in this time of worship, as well as find the friendship pad. We invite you to sign that and let us know that you shared with us in this Reformation worship. We have many things that God is continuing to do, new things that God is doing among us. One of those is volunteering at Ashley Academy for Cultural and Global Studies. It's Ashley Elementary School, and we hope that you will consider joining us for tutoring kindergartners and first graders. If you'd like to find out more information, you can reach out to me, and I would be happy to share more. Our stewardship theme is God is doing a new thing, and we will hear now from a representative from the stewardship committee and then from the worship committee about the new things that God continues to do among us.
Highland Presbyterian Church continues to be a place of thriving ministry, despite the challenges of this long pandemic season. Our deacons, elders, and staff continue to partner with our members and friends to make our mission and ministry happen, so that we can keep being the unique congregation we are. In all of the transformations of this pandemic season, we have sensed that God is at work to renew our ministry. With that, your stewardship committee has chosen a theme for this year. God is doing a new thing. Today we hear from our worship committee. We hope you will appreciate their creative ministry and the difference your generosity makes in the continued renewing of this part of our Highlands ministry. Thank you.
Worship remains at the heart of our life at Highland. It's where we pray and sing, where we hear God's word read and proclaimed, where we gather at the table and the font, and where we hear music that stirs our souls and reminds us of who God is and who we are as followers of Jesus Christ.
In March of 2020, everything changed. And at this time a year ago, everything we did in worship was online. We knew that gathering for worship in any of our normal ways would also put us at risk for spreading this virus. That was not something we wanted to do.
Look at us now. At this point, over a year and a half into the pandemic, we have found all kinds of ways to gather for worship. We still have our online Sunday service, but we are also in the sanctuary on Sunday morning, outdoors for our first Sunday evening communion services, and we even have a midweek prayer service on Zoom.
All of these are ways for us to continue lifting our hearts into God's presence and for the Spirit to renew our faith, our hope, and our love.
We look forward to that time when things will be more normal, but we also give thanks to God for the creativity of this pandemic season and for the ways that God is nudging us to try new ways to draw near to God and to one another.
Our generosity enables this newness to happen. We are grateful for all the ways that our faithful stewardship renews our worshiping life together.
We are grateful for all the ways that God is continuing to work among us. I have one last item to lift up to call to your attention. On Sunday, October 31st, if you are watching this in time, you are invited to an in-person congregational meeting following the in-person 10:30 worship. Our session has called this congregational meeting for the purpose of taking action on the report of the nominating committee regarding their recommendations for deacons and elders serving in the class of 2024. All are welcome to attend this meeting. And now, with gratitude in our hearts for the ways that God continues to reform and reshape us, let us now turn to God in this time of worship.
Called to be God's people, we gather in joy to worship our creating God. Called to be a people of faith, we gather to praise our eternal and loving God. Called to be a people of hope and trust, we gather to give thanks for God's care and compassion towards people who are vulnerable to fears, life, and stress. So let us worship the God who renews us and reforms us. Let us pray. God of all creation, we know that was made by your hands, all that we know and yet also so much more, the farthest reaches of heaven that are even now still unfolding, the secrets of the earth still hidden from our knowing. And so we worship you with all our heart, all our mind, and all our strength. Mighty and powerful before all things and beyond all things, yet always a God who is faithful to all creation, faithful in love,
faithful to save, faithful to tend, faithful to share. With our hearts, we try to love you, for you are our all-loving God. With our human minds, we try to understand you, the all-knowing God. With our human strength, we try to serve you, the all-powerful God. Receive our praise this day and always. Amen.
Seeking to follow Jesus, we often wander down the wrong path. Impatient with God's schedule, we often rush to do things our own way. Let us confess our foolishness that we might receive God's help and God's hope for our lives. We will share together in our unison confession, followed by a time of silent confession. Let us pray. Holy God, you call us to love you with all our heart, with all our soul, and with all our mind. Forgive us when selfishness takes up too much of our heart, when worry seems to crowd wonder out of our soul. When fear causes us to close our minds to anything new. Holy God, you call us to bear with one another in love. Forgive us when we cannot love our neighbors. Forgive us when we cannot love ourselves. Holy God, we thank you for hearing our prayers. Amen. Friends, we may not keep our promises to God. In fact, we don't. But this is the good news. God's promises to us never fail. Friends, hear this good news. God's love and forgiveness are for us because our God is faithful. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Good morning, Highland friends, and welcome to this time for young disciples. I'd like to invite our children to come a little closer this morning. Each Sunday when we gather at this time, we get a message, right? Something from a story, something from a picture book, something from images of nature. But today, we're getting a story from the Bible. And it might very well be the most important message we receive from Jesus. You see, one day, a scribe, that's a person who knows the law very well, came to Jesus and said, "Jesus, what is the most important commandment?" And here's what Jesus said. He said, "Look, I'm going to try to make this as simple as possible. Love God and love your neighbor. Love God with all of your heart and all your soul and your mind and your strength. And love your neighbor as you would love yourself. It's just as simple as that." I mean, what does it really mean to love God with all your heart, your soul, your mind, and your strength? And how in the world do we love our neighbors like we love ourselves? Well, we love God with all our hearts when we keep these two commandments every day. We love God with all of our heart by singing to God, singing praises to God, whether we're at the church in the sanctuary or outside or anywhere. And also when we give thanks to God, when we say, "Thank you for this beautiful day. Thank you for my family who loves me so much. Thank you for my church family." We love God with all our minds when we both study the world that God created and work on taking good care of it. And when we study the Bible and learn how God wants us to live with each other. And we love God with all our strength when we walk in the crop walk, or we write letters of encouragement to people, or if we just simply give someone who's lonely a hug. So maybe it's not so hard to love God and love our neighbors as we thought it was. Actually, it sounds like a lot of fun. And speaking of fun, here's a little message from Randy.
Your call. Love your neighbor as yourself, for God loves us all. Love, 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 love. Christians, this is your call. Love your neighbor as yourself, for God loves us all. Love, 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 love. Christians, this is your call. Love your neighbor as yourself, for God loves us all.
As we come to share our scriptures, let us first come to God in prayer. Spirit of God, we ask that you open our eyes and our ears so that we might see and hear a word from you. Transform us and reform us by your living and holy word, we pray. Amen. Our psalm this day is the 146th. Let us hear now God's word. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, O my soul. I will praise the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praises to my God all my life long. Do not put your trust in princes, in mortals, in whom there is no help. When their breath departs, they return to the earth. On that very day, their plans perish. Happy are those whose help is the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord their God, who made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, who keeps faith forever, who executes justice for the oppressed, who gives food to the hungry. The Lord sets the prisoners free. The Lord opens the eyes of the blind. The Lord lifts up those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous. The Lord watches over the strangers. He upholds the orphan and the widow. But the way of the wicked he brings to ruin. The Lord will reign forever, your God, O Zion, for all generations. Praise the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Our New Testament reading comes from the Gospel of Mark, reading the 12th chapter, verses 28 to 34. Listen now for God's word. One of the scribes came near and heard them disputing with one another, and seeing that he, Jesus, answered them well, he asked him, "Which commandment is the first of all?" Jesus answered, "The first is, 'Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength.' The second is this, 'You shall love your neighbor as yourself.' There is no other commandment greater than these." Then the scribe said to him, "You are right, teacher. You have truly said that he is one, and beside him there is no other. And to love him with all the heart and with all the understanding and with all the strength, and to love one's neighbor as oneself, this is much more important than all whole burnt offerings and sacrifices." When Jesus saw that he answered wisely, he said to him, "You are not far from the kingdom of God." After that, no one dared to ask him any question. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Jesus' words here are among his most familiar. What's it all about? I mean, not just the law, but life itself. What's the point? Why are we here? I mean, that's what the law, the Torah, was trying to shape. When Jesus is asked what commandment matters most, he said that the law all boils down to love. Everything in the law and the prophets comes down to love. Love for God and love for neighbor as for oneself. After Jesus affirms the scribe who has told Jesus that he has answered correctly, you'd think that everyone would have been happy, and that there would have been hugs and tears and joyful high fives and reconciliation amidst all of the tension that Jesus had been having with these religious leaders. I mean, can't you see it? Pharisees, scribes, Sadducees weeping and hugging Jesus, saying, "Thank you. Why couldn't we see that? Of course, love." But after the brief exchange in their conversation that follows our reading this morning, what we get from them instead is silence. Mark says, after that, no one dared ask Jesus any question. No wonder, because if Jesus is right in his answer, then things are going to have to change. As Jesus applied this commandment, this law of love in his own ministry, as far as the leaders of his day were concerned, he was hanging out with all the wrong sorts of people. For Jesus, the law was about love. And for him, that meant spending time with people who had been cut off, bringing them back into the love and the fellowship of God's people. By contrast, for many of the religious leaders of his day, the law was about holiness, about staying away from people like that. I mean, one lived a certain way, doing some things and refraining from doing other things. God was simply the one who was keeping score. And while I would like to say that Jesus' clarification about love here fixed things for all time and eternity, the truth is that we have continued to struggle with what love might mean for us through the ages. On this Reformation Sunday, we give thanks for the witness of our Protestant and Reformed ancestors, including the likes of Martin Luther and John Calvin, who reckoned with what love meant in their own time as well, and what it might mean for not only themselves and the church, but for the world around them. In Luther's day, there wasn't much emphasis on love in the church. The church was the mediator of salvation, and what it emphasized was the importance of doing good and refraining from doing wrong. Not that there's necessarily anything wrong with that, but for those who knew that they were falling short, the sale of indulgences was a way of securing the forgiveness of sins, while also enriching the church at the same time. Now, Luther did everything that he could do to live faithfully, but at the end of every day, he knew that he had fallen short, that he had done things he shouldn't have, that he had not done things he should have. How can I find a gracious God? How can I find a loving God? He asked. So Luther turned to Scripture. He turned to Paul's letters and to stories about Jesus like this one from Mark. And what he discovered there reformed the church. The God of the balance sheet or the ledger, whose job was to count our good deeds and to punish our sins, who could be bought off by the purchase of indulgences, that understanding of God was replaced by a God whose fundamental orientation to us is love. We take that for granted these days, but Luther's discovery started a revolution, a reformation in the church. Now, what that love meant in human life underwent a reformation as well, and John Calvin was at the heart of much of that back in his day. Some of you may recall that there was a big discussion in Calvin's time about the legality of charging interest when lending money. Now, here's the problem. Since it was not legal for those with wealth to charge interest, those folks had no incentive to share their money with others who might need it. Those who were poor desperately needed money, including investments and loans that will enable them to work productively. But no one was willing to share it with them. Calvin held a deep love and a concern for those who lived in poverty in Geneva and around. His problem was that Scripture condemned the practice of charging interest for loans, but he also knew that the 16th century economy of Europe was unlike anything that the authors of Scripture could have imagined. So without a change, he knew that the poor were condemned to their poverty. And so for sake of love, Calvin's teaching reformed the church's understanding and practice, opening the door for those with wealth to charge modest interest. While excessive interest was still condemned, Calvin's interpretation enabled this investment and the transformation of the lives of the poor. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and soul and mind and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. This is at the heart of Jesus' teaching and the church's understanding of the implication of this love commandment has continued to undergo reformation. One of the principles that guides our reading of Scripture is this, that if our reading of Scripture does not increase in us both love for God and love for neighbor, then we're not reading it correctly. I think about Highland and the reformation of love that we have experienced here. Back in the 1960s, when many white congregations were barring physically black folks from being able to enter their sanctuaries, Highland's session declared an open sanctuary policy. When congregations were pondering leaving our denomination because of the rising role of women in church leadership, Highland elected our first woman elder, Helen Clark. We have since provided for same-gender weddings as well, as we have recognized the importance of making room in our life together for those who previously had not been welcome. In the foundation of our Presbyterian polity, we are reminded that the church affirms ecclesia reformata semper reformanda, Latin for the church reformed, always to be reformed. Now, that doesn't mean anything goes, but it does mean that we can be confident that the church tomorrow is going to be different from the church today, because the Spirit continues to be at work in our midst, renewing us, transforming us, keeping us alive and kicking. Our understanding of what it means to love our neighbor continues to be reformed as well. I mean, who could have imagined just 2 years ago that we would be talking about masks and vaccinations as an act of love? But that's certainly what we have seen around here as we have made so many efforts to keep one another safe from this wretched virus. Just a few weeks ago, J. Herbert Nelson, the stated clerk of our denomination, wrote a letter in which he drew on both the Confession of 1967 from our Book of Confessions, as well as Jesus's great love commandment here, when he said, "Because we confess, as a matter of our religious belief, that the members of the church are emissaries of peace and seek the good of all in cooperation with powers and authorities in politics, culture, and economics, we urge all to seek the good of all, to love their neighbor, and get vaccinated." All of this, a new form of love for such time as this. Our practices of love continue to change. So it is with tradition that was born in the Reformation, a church that refuses to stop in time or in place, but instead continues to be open to the reforming and renewing work of God, a God whose will and intention for us is love. Thanks be to God for those in ages past, for those among us now, who show us the way of love as we follow together in the way of Jesus Christ. Amen. Our affirmation of faith is the Apostles' Creed. Let us say together what it is that we believe. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us turn to God in this time of prayer. Reforming God, we give you thanks that you are a God of stability as well as a God of change, that true reformation is your work always being done out of love for your whole creation. Continue to reform us by and for your love. We pray, reforming God, that you will fill Highland and fill your church around the world this day with an openness to your Spirit, that we may hear and receive your promises and grow in our covenant with you. Where we are corrupt, purify us. Where we are in error, direct us. Where we are in need, provide for us. Where we are divided, reunite us. And where we are closed-minded, reform us and make us new. We are grateful for all the ways that you are still at work in the life of the church, doing a new thing, reforming us, reshaping us, remaking us into your image. Help us to reflect your image in how we care for one another, with love and visits and prayers. We pray especially for those in hospice care, for those who are receiving treatment for cancer, for those afflicted by COVID, for those in assisted living and health care, and for all those struggling with mental health issues. We pray for their loved ones and for all who care for them. Help us, O God, to reflect your love and presence as we share our care. O God, we pray that you will help us to look for your image in our neighbors around the world. We pray for those who are imprisoned and martyred because of their faith, for those whose countries are torn apart by war, for those living with hunger, discrimination, natural disaster. May we and more of your children find creative ways to address their needs and do our part in helping remake this world in your image. We pray that we all will be beacons of hope, grace, love and light for this world and for all in our lives. May our open hearts reflect your open arms for all of your children. Hear our prayers spoken aloud and hear the prayers deep within our hearts, all prayed in the name of our Savior Jesus Christ. And hear us now as we pray together the prayer he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
As those who are called to serve our Lord God with all of our heart, all of our mind, and all of our strength, we come to bring our gifts before God, willingly, generously, to share in the work of faithfulness that we share together. So trusting in God's generosity, let us now give generously to share in the work of the Church of Jesus Christ. We give in many ways, including through our online giving portal and through our church office. We also give through our ministry of service and our generosity of our lives. So now let us bring forth this day's tithes and offerings, and let us pray. Gracious and generous God, you call us to love you with all our heart and soul and mind and strength. Accept these offerings we bring before you that they may serve to draw others to love and honor in service to you. Multiply these tithes and offerings, God, and use them for the bringing near of your kingdom and goodness for your people all around the world. We pray this for the sake of love. Amen.
Thank you.
love, 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 love. Christians, this is our call. Love our neighbors as ourselves, for God loves us all. May such love as has been poured out for us in Christ guide our way as we go forth together. And as we go, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be and abide with us this day and forevermore. Amen.